In clinical practice, to determine glucose level in the blood, we use four tests. It's fasting blood glucose level, glycated hemoglobin, glycated albumin, and fructosamine. Also, we have glucose tolerance test, but we use glucose tolerance test to determine whether a patient can use and store glucose normally. So it's more like a functional test. In this video, we will discuss the clinical implications and the major differences between glucose tests. First of all, why glucose tests are so important? Because according to current guidelines, only based on glucose tests, we can make a diagnosis of prediabetes and diabetes. And as a criteria for diabetes, we use glycated hemoglobin, fasting blood glucose level, glucose tolerance test, and random plasma glucose. Also, for example, to make a diagnosis of hypoglycemia, we need to know blood glucose level. As we see, glycated hemoglobin and fasting blood glucose level are two most important glucose tests. As an additional option, we can determine the level of fructosamine and the level of glycated albumin. They are not so popular tests, but they are also available, so at least we have to know their clinical implications. And to explain the logic of glucose tests, we have to know physiology. So in the blood we have glucose molecules, also we have albumins as the most common proteins, and the fraction of other proteins. And in addition to this, we have red blood cells, and the red blood cells inside them have hemoglobin. The specific feature of glucose is that glucose non-enzymatically can bind to proteins, including hemoglobin inside the red blood cells. And we call this process glycation. Before we discovered glycated hemoglobin, we thought that sugars cannot bind to proteins without help of enzymes. But as it turns out, anything is possible. And this non-enzymatic binding of sugars to proteins we call glycation. And glycation is possible only due to the Browning reaction. When glucose binds to hemoglobin, which is protein, this process we call non-enzymatic glycation, and this reaction results in formation of glycated hemoglobin. One of the examples of the Browning effect is coffee roasting. With increasing temperature, sugars inside the bean begin to caramelize. And the higher the amount of caramelized sugars in the bean, the darker becomes the bean color. Exactly this caramelization happens to proteins in the presence of glucose. And the higher the blood glucose level, the higher becomes the rate of glycation. And as you may guess, glycation or caramelization brings nothing but problems to proteins. So some glucose molecules, without any enzymes, irreversibly bind to hemoglobin. And such hemoglobin with binded glucose we call glycated hemoglobin. And the normal level of glycated hemoglobin is less than 5.7%. Because red blood cells live in the circulation for 90 to 120 days, glycated hemoglobin provides information about the average blood glucose level for the past 8 to 12 weeks. So in clinical practice it's extremely important, because simply from one single value, we can know what was the average blood glucose level for the past 3 to 4 months. And glucose can bind to albumins. And glycation of albumins results in formation of glycated albumins. In clinical practice, we use the ratio of glycated albumins to all albumins. And the ratio should be less than 14%. So only 14% of albumins in normal condition are glycated. The same story for other proteins. Glucose can glycate them too. And the value that reflects the fraction of glycated proteins from total protein count is fructosamine. So by fructosamine, we can determine how many proteins in the blood are glycated. In normal condition, fructosamine level is between 205 and 285. Because proteins live in the circulation approximately 2-3 weeks, fructosamine and glycated albumins provide information about the average blood glucose level for the past 2-3 weeks. And if you want information about glucose level right now, we use fasting blood glucose level. In normal condition, blood glucose level should be less than 100 mg per deciliter or less than 5.6 millimoles per liter. So, fasting blood glucose level provides information of glucose level right now. But if something is going wrong and some pathology causes increase in blood glucose level, now things becomes more interesting. If blood glucose level becomes in between 100 and 125, or 5.6 to 6.9 millimoles, it's a marker of prediabetes. The higher the glucose concentration, the higher the rate of glycation. So, with increase in blood glucose level, glycation increase. So now, additional hemoglobin molecules get glycated. And if glycated hemoglobin becomes in between 5.7 to 6.4%, it's a marker of prediabetes. With increase in blood glucose level, glycation of albumin increase. And the more albumin molecules becomes glycated, the higher becomes the ratio. So now the ratio becomes greater than 14%. Also, with increase in blood glucose level, the glycation of other proteins increase. And now fructosamine will be higher than 285. If disorder progress and blood glucose level becomes even higher, first of all, fasting blood glucose level will increase even further. And when fasting blood glucose level becomes higher than 126 or greater than 7 millimoles, it's a marker of diabetes. As we know, with increase in blood glucose level, glycation increase. With increase in hemoglobin glycation, the level of glycated hemoglobin increase even further. And when glycated hemoglobin becomes greater than 6.5, it's a criteria of diabetes. With increase in blood glucose level, glycation of albumin increase. So the fraction of glycated albumin will be even higher. And also, glycation of other proteins increase. And increase in glycated albumin together with increase in glycated other proteins cause increase in fructosamine. If we have to choose what is the most important test, it will be glycated hemoglobin. The level of glycated hemoglobin is the major criteria of prediabetes or diabetes. Because we know that in normal condition it should be lower than 5.7. If glycated hemoglobin is between 5.7 to 6.4, it's prediabetes. And greater than 6.5, it's diabetes. Also, by the level of glycated hemoglobin, we can suppose what was the average blood glucose level for the last 90 to 120 days. For example, if glycated hemoglobin is 7%, then most probably the average glucose level for this time period was 154 or 8.6 millimoles.